Perfect. So welcome everybody to workshop three. Hopefully most of you, I know there are a couple of new faces here and that's absolutely fine. You can catch up on workshops one and two. I believe that the team have sent around some links and you can find it all online. It's definitely worth doing without floating our own boats. I hope that there's a lot of helpful information in the previous workshops. This one is all about creating a value proposition. So for anyone who this is their first time, I'll just give you a quick intro to myself and my colleague Mark, who's helping me out today. So my name's Laura Parr, and I am a business coach and I specialise in helping women to set up what I call conscious businesses. So it's basically businesses from scratch. I help them take it from, I have a bit of an idea and I'm not really sure what to do with it, all the way through to it being a productive business. But I like to specialize in conscious businesses, which is something that whereby you include some kind of social or economic or environmental benefit to running the business, not just about making a bunch of money. So hopefully I'm very, very well placed to be able to help you with today. And of course, if you have any questions along the way and you want to ask, you can always connect with Mark and I and Ed and Howard, the other two members of the team, on LinkedIn afterwards, or just utilize the time that you have with us now and ask away. So Mark, would you like to say a quick hello as well?
Absolutely. Hi there, everybody. My name is Mark, and I'm one of the founders and directors here at Edvent, where everything we do is about unleashing your potential, figuring out how we grow your skills, attitudes, and whether you want to go build businesses, social businesses, or whatever it might be. That's where we're here to help. I'm also the founder and director of a business called Thrust Carbon. We're the leading emissions intelligence business for travel. Everything we do is about driving emissions down. So I have a broad portfolio of work, but I'm laser focused on basically trying to improve all of our abilities to have a lasting impact on the world. So that's me. I go through this process an incredibly regular amount, both personally with the people that I work with, coaches and people on the Edvent programs. I cannot say how much I value the value proposition canvas, the biz model canvas, and how good today's session is. It really does give you so much focus, structure, and tools to help you figure out that focus and structure as well. So yeah, Laura's going to kick off the first half of the session, and then I'm going to do the second half.
Excellent. And yeah, this is a really, really good session, actually. It will build on some of the stuff that you've done in workshops one and two. So if you haven't done workshops one and two, don't worry. You can still do it without that. But it is just helpful, I guess, to be able to pop back and look at some of the information. Okay. All right. Well, let's kick off. So today's goals, we're going to understand the importance of your value proposition. We're going to create it. And there's a brilliant framework that we're going to use to show you how to do that nice and simply and easily. And then we're going to develop your lean canvas. All of this is going to become a little bit more apparent when you see what we're talking about. But that's what we're going to be covering. We're going to start off in a very logical place. What is your value proposition? And then we'll move on to the two different canvases and we'll go through them one by one. So the reason that we're doing all of this is that 72% of product innovations fail to deliver on customer expectations. So, you know, we've done a previous session on, you know, knowing your customer, for example, and being able to understand the problem statement. And that's a really, really good foundation for this, because where your value is derived is where you are helping to solve somebody's problem. And we stress over and over and over again, and I'm sure if you've been to the previous sessions, you'll know that speaking to your customers is hugely, hugely important, because it's where you find out where their value is as well. So there's no point in coming up with this amazing idea and you think it's the best thing since sliced bread, it's going to be the next Google, you came up with it in your sleep or asleep or in the bathtub, and it's the best thing you've ever come up with, if you don't test the theory. You know, is it something that somebody else would want? Is it something that actually solves the problem, or is it just a bit of a nice to have? How big a problem does it solve? You know, where is the value that you're delivering? Or is it just a sort of shiny, pretty object that some people might like, but it's not really actually going to make you anything? So being able to articulate the value that your product or your service actually has to the market is really important. And another thing that we're going to sort of go over today and stress a little bit as well is the difference between understanding your customers' needs and their wants as well. So we'll go in a bit. So first off, a few quick questions. So I want this to be a little bit sort of participatory. So either unmute yourself and let me know the answers, or if you can write it in the chat. In presentation mode, I can't see the chat. So Mark, you might need to help me out on that one. But I want you guys to have a think about what word or words that you associate with the following brands. Okay, so brand number one is Volvo. What does Volvo say to you?
Reliable.
Absolutely.
Convenient.
Okay. That's cool.
Affordable and safe.
Affordable and safe. Okay, great. If we can make sure that if unless you're speaking, could everybody put themselves on mute just so that we can make sure everyone else can hear? Perfect. Thank you very much. Appreciate it. Okay. So yeah, I think as we mentioned, safety is one of the big things when you think about a Volvo. I think we even had this one is the word safety comes to mind. So you don't even need to really see any advertisements. You've just seen their logo and you're automatically thinking of safety. Has everyone heard of DuckDuckGo? Does anyone know what word you would associate with DuckDuckGo? Any suggestions?
A child game?
Okay. So DuckDuckGo is like a web browser that essentially, I'm going to give the answer away by saying it. So I'll just go through this one. So it's anonymity. They're basically a web browser that specializes in making sure that sort of the searches are particularly anonymous and cyber safety is one of their big things, basically. So kind of only works this game when you actually know the company.
Shimara got it right, as did someone identifying as guest.
Okay, cool. Perfect. Happy days. How about Slack? Hopefully people know Slack. This is a program that you can use. A lot of companies use this. A lot of startups use this. It's very good for getting all of your team members on board and being able to work together on the one program. I won't say any more just in case it gives it away.
Collaboration and connection.
Mm-hmm. And what might it increase if you're collaborating better? What does it increase?
Efficiency.
Yeah, efficiency. Yeah, absolutely. You're almost spot on, almost there. It's basically productivity, which is, you know, essentially the more efficient you are, the more productive you are. So it's same, but different. So it's a really, really good tool. If you don't know it, it's definitely worth having a look up. It might be something that is useful to you in your startup journey. But Slack's associated with the word productivity. So the idea behind all of this is that successful products and successful brands, the value is actually synonymous with the brand itself. So there's certain brands that you don't need to see an advert, you don't need to see anything but the logo, and sometimes not even the logo, to know that that particular product means something. So that is the aim of where you kind of want to get to. That's almost the pinnacle. But you can see, therefore, how important understanding a brand's value actually is, because if you communicate it correctly and you get it right and you've listened to your customers and you are actually providing the value that the customers want in the first place, then this is what helps you to create a brand that is synonymous with, you know, the message that you're trying to put forward. So as an example, we've got the case study of Apple and the evolution of it. So this is one of their first ever adverts. And as you can see, it's very wordy. There's a lot going on. And it's not particularly exciting. A dot matrix printer that will improve your image. I mean, that doesn't really thrill me, if I'm honest. I doubt that it would thrill many people. And this is what I was saying earlier, a little bit earlier, about the fact that we're going to go through wants and needs and understanding your customers' true wants. You almost sell to their wants, but you provide what they need, if that makes sense. So, you know, they might need a printer. And they might need a dot matrix one as well, but that doesn't mean anything to anybody. Nobody really knows, unless you're in the industry or if it's something that is, you know, really, really specialist to you, what dot matrix actually really means. But considering Apple was selling to the general public and this was all brand new, completely afresh, it hadn't really been in the market before, knowing what a dot matrix printer was not very common. So they sold to the wrong aspect. What you want to be doing is you want to be saying, yeah, you actually do need a dot matrix printer, but let me sell to the benefits for you. You know, what is it that this printer is going to provide? How is it going to change your life? Why is it that you need my product, my service? But this, at the end of the day, this is where Apple started. And it's clearly worked for them because they're pretty big. But they have altered along the way quite drastically the way that they advertise their value proposition across to their customers. So quite a long time ago now, they then decided that they were going to scrap all the information, forget everything about what it is we provide, how it works, what the sort of specialisms are of each individual printer or phone or, you know, whatever it was that they had on the market at the time. And actually, they wanted you to just associate their brand with thinking different. So they tried to associate themselves with some incredible revolutionaries. Hopefully these are, you know, fairly self-explanatory. You'll probably recognize all, maybe if not most of them at least, as being some great minds. So the fact that they even associate with these people, it brings up an image or a feeling of, we're revolutionary, we're creating something different, and we are the product for the person that wants to be the next person to create something different. So I'm going to show you now as an example, in fact, let me get this up, the advert that they used. And hopefully this will give you an idea as to what we mean.
Here's to the crazy ones, the misfits, the rebels, the troublemakers, the round pegs in the square holes, the ones who see things differently. They're not fond of rules, and they have no respect for the status quo. You can quote them, disagree with them, glorify or vilify them. About the only thing you can't do is ignore them. Because they change things. They push the human race forward. And while some may see them as the crazy ones, we see genius. Because the people who are crazy enough to think they can change the world are the ones who do.
There we go. Let's just get back to my slides. There we are. So can you see in that as an example, that was one of their old adverts, I think back from the 80s or so. Not once did they mention a laptop. Not once did they mention a phone or a printer or anything that they provided. They didn't talk about any sort of specificities as to how they create things. They literally just wanted you to be able to associate Apple as a brand with this idea of revolutionary. They mentioned the word genius. You know, these are all sort of big emotive trigger words that will appeal to their ideal customer, so that their ideal customer is sitting there thinking, I want that. because I want to be associated with genius. I am a genius, therefore I want this Apple product, and it has to be Apple versus anything else, because that's what I know that I'm going to be associated with. So it's very, very clever marketing. So what is the value proposition? It's a good place to start. So a value proposition is a promise of value that's going to be delivered to your customer. So it outlines who it is that you're targeting, what their pains and their potential gains are, i.e. the reasons why they want to be buying from you. And then it offers three things. So number one is relevancy. So explain how your product solves the customer's problems or improves their situation. And this is a really, really important thing. And I've worked on this with many, many of my clients. You tend to want to, once you've got something, you tend to want to kind of show off what you've created, show off what you've provided, and you want to explain the features of whatever it is that you're selling. And that's all well and good, but nobody's really interested in the features. No one really cares. You know, they might be like, oh, well done you, but they don't see the relevance of it to them. So this is why it's an absolute game changer sometimes for people to step away from that and try and think around their brand and think, what is it that my customer actually wants? I'm solving a problem for them, but what's the emotion around that problem? What's the pain point? And the idea of being able to explain to them nothing about how your product works, or, you know, especially if it's a tech product, going into the sort of the real techie detail about, you know, what algorithms have been used and all these sorts of different things. You don't see anybody doing that because nobody cares. What we care about is, how is it going to help me? What's it going to do to me? How is it going to change my life? I have this problem. How are you going to solve it? So understanding the relevancy of the product, and knowing, and for you as the product maker or the service provider, knowing the pains and knowing what it is that they're, the potential gains that they're going to have from using your product or service is huge. So it's, and this I know was covered in previous sessions, so again, it's definitely worth making sure you don't skip that step, because it really helps the value proposition when you get to this stage. A quantified value, so deliver specific benefits. It's perfectly okay for you to be able to explain the benefits to people. You know, what is it that your product or service does for them? But the more specific you can be, the better. You know, stats and figures always really help to raise the relevancy and the credibility of your product and your service. And then finally, differentiation. So tell the ideal customer why it is that they should buy from you and not from the other competition. You know, so with Apple, you know, there are other computers, there are other, providers of phones and so forth. But why is it that they are completely different? And I bet if I asked most people, you'd be able to give me a list of a few reasons as to why Apple was completely different to some of their competitors. So why is it that people want to buy from you when somebody else might be providing exactly the same thing just around the corner? And now, what makes a great value proposition? So this is essentially the formula for creating a value proposition. So we're going to go through this together, and then we're going to have a go at producing one for a very well-known company that hopefully you should all know as a bit of a practice. And then obviously you can have a go at doing this for yourself and for your own venture. So you start off by saying we serve, and then who it is that you serve, and then putting in their needs. So we serve. And again, be specific with this. So people is not an acceptable word. I tell my clients all the time, you don't serve people. It's too general. You need to be very, very niche and specific about it. Who need a particular X, Y, and Z. Our app or our product or service does X, Y, and Z. And that benefits them in what way? Okay, so as an example, for anybody that came to previous sessions, we've used the example before of See the Signs. So this is an app used by doctors to help to diagnose early stages of cancer. And this is their value proposition. So See the Signs serves GPs who struggle to catch early stage signs of cancer. So it's very clear who it's serving, what it is that they want, what their problem is. Their intuitive AI-powered app gives GPs the expert tools to predict the most likely cancers and also referral guidelines to give them actionable steps to support the patient. Their app helps save time, money, and potentially hundreds of thousands of lives by catching signs of cancer 30% earlier than existing solutions. So you can see there in a very succinct couple of paragraphs, you know, who it's serving, you know, what their problem is, you know, how they do it, and you know what the benefits are, and you've got a stat there to show you exactly how beneficial that product is going to be for them. Very, very easy. And this makes a really good start if you're going for funding or if you're in this competition, for example, and you're looking to, you know, portray the idea to the judges. This is a really clear, concise way of doing that. So we're going to create Airbnb's value proposition. So we're going to take about 5 minutes now to just step away on your own, have a think. What do you think that Airbnb's value proposition is? I'll go back to the previous slide so that you can see the kind of the formula and the way that you want to set it out. But just so that you know, Airbnb is an interesting one because you've got two sets of customers, haven't you, with Airbnb? You've got the first set, which is the people with the properties that want to be renting them out. You've also got the people that are using Airbnb to go and book properties. So it's entirely up to you as to whether you want to create one value proposition across the board, or you may decide that actually the value and the benefits and the differentiation between the two is big enough that you want to create two value propositions. So I'll leave that one with you. It's entirely up to you for that. But what I'll do now is go back to the formula, which is that one there. And we're going to have 5 minutes. So what's it now? 27 minutes past. So we'll come back at about 4:33-ish, 4:32. So take that 5 minutes to have a go. If anyone's confused or got any questions or wants to clarify anything, Mark and I will both still be here. So please just ask. And that's it. We'll see you in five. Does anybody want to give it a go and unmute themselves and let us know what they've come up with for Airbnb's value proposition? There's no pressure, you don't have to, but it is quite good practice. And like I say, utilise us while we're here.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you. Hi.
Hello. I said we serve adventurers who love to explore and travel. Our homes is your home away from home that allows you to feel, that allows you to choose your solace and feel free without the worry of hidden fees.
Love it. Great. There's some really good benefits in there for sure. And very like emotive description. I like that. One thing that I always notice with stuff like this is the specificity of the needs. So we could go into more detail, for example, about why is it that they, what need does it solve that a hotel, doesn't, for example, because that's an alternative, right, is that they could just stay in a hotel. So what is it that the Airbnb provides that is the differentiating factor between that and a hotel? And part of that is additional locations. Hotels are great, but you get sort of 300 rooms in one particular spot, whereas if you want to kind of be halfway up the mountain down around the corner or up the road, it's not really possible, whereas Airbnbs can provide you that sort of level of intimacy, I suppose, as well, and variation in terms of the location that you're able to pick. So those are kind of things that can be incorporated, but I love the sort of emotive descriptive words because that's really going to appeal to a customer. Anybody else want to give it a go? Did anybody go for it, going for the two different value propositions? Or anybody go for it from the perspective of the person using Airbnb to advertise their place?
We've got a question from Nia.
Oh, yeah, go for it.
No, sorry, I thought I had to raise my hand to speak.
Oh, okay, gotcha. No, that's fine. No worries. Okay, no worries. Well, hopefully you can see from that a little bit more about just how it all slots together and how easy it can be to put a value proposition together when you know these individual elements of the structure, basically. So we're going to go into now the actual value proposition canvas itself. So Mark, do you want to take them through this?
Absolutely. Fab. So hopefully my screen is just coming on. And it's nice and clear. So we are at 4:35. We're going to do about a 10 minute or so intro to this. And then we'll take a quick little break, get some teas, coffees, you name it, and then crack on. So let's go full screen. The canvas is the tool for how we build our value proposition really effectively. Not only that, when you see us go through this, you'll find there are lots of gaps in what you know about your customers or what you're delivering for them, and that's okay, right? This is, as ever, an iterative process. It's about getting V1 and then going off and doing some more learning, coming back and doing V2, doing more learning, V3, and so on. And it really is that simple. Sometimes with entrepreneurship, it is just putting one foot in front of the other, keeping moving, learning new things, and giving it a good old go. And with that, it also really helps you nail your entrepreneurship program application. If you cannot clearly articulate what it is that you fundamentally do and the value you bring to your customer, it's very difficult for the team to evaluate whether it's going to be a good business. So this is such a powerful way of getting that over the line, being really understood, and then people can dive into the nitty-gritty of how it works, why you, and all the other fun things. So with that, actually, Laura, if you can copy and paste into the chat the link to the worksheet, because then you can download this and you can scribble as we go. I'm going to show you what this looks like and then walk you through the example of Lonely Joan. Fab. So on the right hand side, we have customer. On the left, we have product. And on the bottom, we have your company name, your product, your ideal customer that you're doing it for, and substitutes, all of which I shall explain. First off, customers. We've talked previously about needs and wants. What is the difference between a need and a want? Who knows the difference between needs and wants?
A customer may want something, however, it doesn't necessarily mean they need it.
Absolutely. And then to expand on that, Hannah has said need is a necessity and want is a luxury. Yeah, it's hard to define wants and needs without using the words wants and needs. So a good way of putting it is things you actively need. So there you go, I've done it immediately. Things that you are required for survival. So on the most basic level, it's water, shelter, safety, all of that kind of stuff. And then maybe from a business perspective, it's what do I need in order to provide for my employees, grow the business, supply chain, etc. And then the wants are the things that you would really, really like, but aren't actually vital for your success. So a classic example is all entrepreneurs go, oh, Mark, you know what I need? I need $1 million and then I could launch my amazing business. Do you need $1 million? The average amount of money that a startup is launched with is $3,000. That's average. So bearing in mind how many people will launch with $1 million, right? It shows how many more people will launch with absolutely nothing, or 50 quid, right? Which they spend on a SurveyMonkey and a, you know, Google Workspace account, for example, right? I don't need a top of the range phone. I do need a phone in order to call customers and call my team. So there's a distinction, right? again, another classic example is people buying cars. You don't need a car that's straight out of the showroom. You just want a car that's straight out of the showroom. If you were smart enough to realize that it loses half its value the second you get in it and drive it out, then you'd have more money to invest in your business. So wants and needs, and you will see in life how little people understand this. And then Hannah also mentioned luxury. For those of you who are building luxury products, or indeed products that you might say, well, I don't know if it's a need, what you are then trying to create is something that people desperately want, right? So I might not need that top of the line, straight out box fresh iPhone. So how do you then create the desire in me that I desperately, desperately, desperately want it, right? And that's what Apple do incredibly well. You know, it's so easy to use. It plugs into everything. You know, it's got the best camera so I can do all my podcasting and social influencing with the nicest screen, and I'll feel great, and then I'll put it down in meetings and I'll feel like I'm a successful CEO just by virtue of having a nice iPhone. You see how they're tapping into what you desperately want rather than necessarily what you need. And again, tapping into your fears, right? So the fear that I'm not seen as a credible, successful CEO might be linked to me thinking, oh my God, I've got a terrible phone, and therefore people will look at me like I'm so poor, I can't afford a nice phone. Right? That's a genuine fear that a lot of people will have. And you can amplify that to anything, size of my team, my age, whatever. But actually, you know, a lot of this stuff when it comes to fears is internal, right? And you balance it with something else. So those are wants and fear, needs and fears. Then on the product side, what we want to do is map those customer needs, fears, wants onto the experience, the features and the benefits, right? And then it's a really simple yes or no. Do the things that you're building on the product, solve first and foremost the needs, then answer the fears, then the wants, right? And when you really start, arguably you want to only do one thing and do it really well, which is hitting the needs. And we're going to fill out a live example of this in a moment as well. I'll go back into the slideshow. So this canvas helps you effectively understand this. You'll find if you don't understand these things, you then want to go and do more customer development. You might find that you map different customer segments onto one document. You might find you have multiple documents for multiple customer types. That's up to you. As long as you start somewhere, you'll grow it and do something else. Then this also allows you to truly understand benefits versus features, and then really map everything you're going to focus on. And again, it gives you space. A lot of these activities are about getting what's in your head out of in your head onto paper so you can start mapping them. Some of your wants or things that you're not sure if they're a need or a want, you go, cool, this is stuff that's going to come later. But in version one, we're only tackling this one big problem. Can't do everything. You got to focus, right? Businesses that do one thing and do it really, really well always move faster and are more successful than businesses that do too many things. Because more things, more problems, more resources, more cost, more risk, more potential problems, more points of failure, lower chances of success, right? Applies to everything. So let's dig out our customer profile. The questions you're asking here really, what are the emotional drivers for the wants? The fears, what are the concerns, risks, and needs? What are the rational drivers? And then what are the hidden needs? So hidden needs is really important because people forget these because they're hidden. So let's say you're selling a really awesome chair or a cushion, something to alleviate back pain while I'm working. Great, cool product, clear problem, I've got back pain. But the hidden need isn't that I necessarily need a cushion to make my back pain less. The hidden need is I might need to do more exercise, right? I need to have a less sedentary lifestyle, working in tech, building a business, sitting at this desk. So that might be a long-term solution. That doesn't mean you can't still sell me the cushion today or the chair today, but it might mean you have a shelf life. So then once you've sold me the cushion, are you selling me something else, right? So it's good to look forwards and be very aware of the hidden needs, because what you don't want to do is build a cool cushion business and then you don't get any repeat business. Fab. So yes, now mapping it against Lonely Joan, who you might remember from previous sessions. This is one of our examples, elderly lady in a retirement home, you know, on a pension, isolated, lonely, missing her family. So she's got very clear goals, which, you know, you've understood by doing your customer research, talking to Joan face to face, calling up the pardon me, care home managers and diving into this. So you know her goals, some of her motivations, and then what you want to do is map this onto your value proposition. So literally you're copying and pasting these things and popping them on there. So identifying her priorities, ultimately number one is more frequent contact with relatives. Everything else is secondary to that, right? So if you build an app that solves problem or priority number five, which is doing fun, creative things, is it what Joan needs? No, it is not. What she needs is more frequent contact with relatives. The doing creative things might just be the way of helping her engage with it or making the app more engaging, more fun, more usable, et cetera, et cetera. So this priority is important. And the priority might come after you map this, because it might be helpful to actually put it on the wants, needs and fears. So the wants, that creativity piece, she wants to be able to remember how to use it. She wants to feel good using it. But deeper than this, we have the fears that she's lonely, the fears that she misses her family or they miss her or they don't know how to get in touch. She doesn't know how to get in touch. Maybe she's embarrassed. She feels bad asking her Gen Z granddaughter to consistently explain how to use this rubbish app she's using. And then you get to her very clear needs, right? The app needs to be easy to use and it needs to deliver the number one outcome, which is decreasing her feeling of loneliness, which you do by frequent contact with relatives. So it's really nicely worked out. When you first do this, you know, you will be debating whether something is a need or a want. You might put things right on the border because, you know, it's a want, but you feel like it's becoming a need or it's very close to something that they desperately, desperately want. Fab. Then we get to the product side. So experience, benefits, features, the key questions. What does it feel like to use the product, right? Think about it, touching with it and utilizing it, right? Cushion, you know, feels nice. You know, I enjoy leaning into it, right? But the benefit of the cushion is I feel better, less pain, more focused, better at work, right? Outcomes, impact, right? My phone makes me money by being able to keep on top of my emails on the tube while I'm underground, right? Impact is the benefits, and that's what people pay for. The features is how you get there. Nice screen, super fast internet, you know, all the bells and whistles, right? Cushion, comes in multiple sizes, comes in velvet, organic cotton, a recycled material you've made yourself. You know, and then, you know, the features of the material, it's 68% this, whatever percent this. These are the features which are important, but I don't buy the features. I'm buying it because it's the world's most sustainable eco cushion that's good for people's backs. Brilliant. And my experience with it is that it's super awesome to use. So that's the flow that you're kind of going through and a trap to fall into. When explaining businesses, people talk about features. So using Laura's example of Apple, that first ad where they talk about, would you like a faster floppy drive and this, that, and the other. And it's like, you're talking technical language, you know. And if someone goes, would you like materials? Would you like your nice shirt to be made out of X materials or Y materials? Most people are like, I don't really care. Right, it's the benefits. It's made out of comfier materials, more sustainably made, or whatever it might be. So don't fall into the features trap. How's this sounding so far? Quick check-in. I'm seeing some heads nodding. Fab. Right. And question from Denisa?
Hi, I was wondering, can you hear me okay?
Yeah.
I was wondering if it changed in any way, if we don't kind of refer to like a consuming persona, but rather to like a governing body, like a government or like an institution. Do these kind of like propositions change in the way we analyze them?
No, just someone's purchasing something. So consumer, client is generally the word you might use when you're selling to businesses or large organizations rather than customer, but it's the same thing. And again, if you're selling into government or indeed anyone selling into large corporates, yes, you're selling to a large organization, but you've also got to remember you're still selling to an individual, right? Like, you don't buy something from Westminster Council, you buy something from Hannah, who leads the youth initiative for young people in Westminster Council, as an example. So what you might want to do here is map the needs of Westminster Council, as in this example, but then you might have a separate one that's for Hannah. So someone who works there, obviously very committed to working with young people, but then understanding her insights, like, does she have super limited cash flow? You know, is she trying to impress her boss? Does she feel overwhelmed? Is this a passion project? Is it a core focus? You know, this is a trap that a lot of B2B, so business to business, people miss when they're first doing it, right? Like, you're selling to an organization, but it's a human that will say yes to your product or your service. I hope that answers your question. It was a good question, Denisa.
It was a great answer. Thank you so much.
You're welcome. You can tell I sell into corporates and businesses a lot, so I'm used to this. I would be lost making a retail product or a nice consumer product. I'd be useless. Fab. Right, then the next stage we get to, and then we'll take a quick break just to show you this. This is then the user map, right? So now we're mapping your needs on the right-hand side against the features that you're going to build, right? So we've got that creativity link for Joan. Maybe you're going to allow her to make voice notes, can save pictures or upload pictures, save a portfolio of work, great. But in doing this, it also allows you to go, these are features, these are things that we can build, but this is also not priority number one. If we build an app that does this, Joan will say, hey, it's lovely, but she's not going to use it because she needs to have frequent contact with her relatives. So we go to the next one where we've got, let's say we've got an AI tool that generates calendar integrations with the whole family. It automatically does calls, reminders, you know, fun, whatever it is that drives that engagement. And then, of course, we then get to the feature, the user need, which is ease of use. So when you build the app, you specifically intentionally build it to be as easy to use as possible. Maybe use much bigger buttons and you have an app that might look really ugly to someone in Gen Z. That's okay, because Gen Z is not your audience. So I don't value their opinions in this case. I value Joan's opinion, right? Customer centric. And then if you're not doing these things, it becomes very easy to assess why the business isn't working, because you have a mismatch between what you build and the customer needs. And again, that's a really simple trap people fall into all the time. So this is a brilliant tool just to map these out against each other. And if I come out of the slides, in the document I sent round, we have our value proposition toolkit. Please download this as a Word file, as a PDF, and you can edit it, put sticky notes on it, draw on it, whatever you like, and start doing version one. So what we'll do now is we'll take a quick little break. So go grab a tea, coffee, come back at the top of the hour. And if you don't need to go anywhere, then let's start working on the value proposition together.
One very quick thing that I just need to reiterate, because we get someone that says this every single time. Make sure when you open up the link that both Mark and I sent round, that you click file and save as, or save a copy, so that you're not editing the one that's currently on the screen, because it is a shared document. So make sure that you save your own copy first. Otherwise, we'll all be able to see what you've written, and there'll be about 20 different people trying to work on the same document. So just a little tip. Thanks, guys. See you in a few minutes.
Fab. So with that, I hope you've all got a nice cup of tea or a snack, or just enjoyed a couple of minutes recharge. So I'll finish off this example and then let's spend some time working on our own. So up here, you can now see how we're mapping out the experience. So using the app in this case would feel highly intuitive. It goes straight into, video calls, perhaps, like a go-to means of connecting. You know, it brings Joan joy. She experiences joy. She feels connected, and it becomes a part of her habits, her routine. Let's say, you know, every day at Tuesday 11, she does X, right? Habits, behaviors, and so forth. The more it becomes ingrained into people's habits and their existing workflows or daily lives, the better. And that applies to everything, right? Like, do I feel excited going to work because now I have my nice cushion? Am I using your emailing tool as part of my day-to-day email you know, program, etc. The benefits, you know, what it brings, joy, connection, easy to use, seamless scheduling, maybe carers are picking up health risks, great, right? And then the features, the how is it that you're actually doing that? So you have a specific calendar integration, you have, you know, this intuitive UX with big buttons, you name it, you know, friendly language, maybe it's voice activated, and so forth. So really nicely, clearly split. And if you're struggling with features versus benefits, really think outcomes, right? These are things that you can measure by asking if they're achieved, right? Fab. And then the one thing I haven't mentioned so far is the substitutes. This is a good understanding. What else would they use if they don't use you? So if we're talking about my back friendly cushion, other substitutes might just be cushion from my sofa, or it might be I buy a different chair, or I buy a standing desk. So think around the problem as well. This is where, you know, you might put substitutes. If you're releasing, if you're making a nice book, well, why are people not buying your book? Because they might be watching Netflix instead, right? It's think broadly around the problem, not just what if they're buying other cushions. Fab. So with that, let's take 10 minutes. Let's go to 10 past. Let's start doing our first versions. So you've got the toolkit here. Please start mapping some of these things out. Again, you're going to have lots of gaps, especially if you haven't spoken to your customer yet. So you might write down assumptions, you know, hypotheses, and then put in brackets, you know, go prove this with customer, right? If you're telling me, you know anecdotally Joan's going to be lonely, but then you might have the action that is go survey or speak to 10 people in a local nursing home and find out what their day-to-day experience actually is and what can I learn from it. So let's kick that off, and then I'm going to answer a question that we've got in chat. So yeah, please do just hit file, download, and you can download as a PDF, Word document, whatever you fancy, print it, scribble it, post-it notes. If you've got a second screen, you know, you name it. This is a good time if you want to share your screen or ask specific questions. If there are gaps in your knowledge.
It might seem a little daunting if you're wondering how many people are on the call, but it's a really good opportunity to get some great feedback. So I would 100% suggest that you guys utilize it if you can. And it doesn't matter if you haven't, if there are certain things that are missing from here. We don't need to see a full and completed one. So any questions you have, throw them at us. Sounds like everyone's mastered it.
Hello, hi.
Hi.
Yes. Well, I was trying to do the Canvas, but like you have said that if we have questions, we can share them. Well, this is like a very, my question or what I was like curious to know what you will said about it is, if I am interested of like which kind of canvas do you think that entrepreneur like something like Disney or DreamWorks did? That's my question. Because I think that in some weird way, because I'm a performer maker, I'm a little bit interested in that, and it's very creatively, but this there is a necessity there, there is a once obviously. But like I was curious if you know where I can find something in that particular niche that is a very broad niche at the same time.
Yeah, I wouldn't describe anything about Disney as niche. or performance, right? Like it's a huge.
Or maybe that's why I'm like curious of what you can share.
Yeah. So a really good one for you to look for is I'd look at the origin story of Pixar. So it's very well documented. And funny enough, the original team, John Bird, I feel like there was another John, and then there was Steve Jobs and a couple of others, and they almost called it like a brain trust. And they literally just had really smart people in a room together being like, how, and they were asking big questions, you know, how would we, or how could we use latest trends in animation to create compelling stories, right? You know, and you start with these hypotheses, like, you know, could I make a better, more engaging, more, or could I make a story that is as popular as Snow White 100 years ago today? And then how would you do that? Right. So big open questions, big lofty goals really go a long way. Right. And then, you know, you might analyze your audience first. So, you know, when you think about film, you might go, well, no one age five is buying their way into the cinema, but there's a lot of five-year-olds who go to the cinema. So really you're persuading the parents to make a purchasing decision. And how do you do that, right? Pixar are notorious for their naughty jokes, shall we say. And in fact, most of them are like jokes that make adults laugh and make them feel like they've had a nice time while spending their time with their kids, right? So again, it's understanding your cross audience as well. Another really fun story is Nike. So there's a really great Phil Knight, the founder of Nike, did an amazing talk, which you can find online. Can't remember when it was, but he got up on stage and went, "Cool, so stand up if you're a runner here." And you know, like 80% of the audience stands up, like, "Yeah, I'll go running." And then he goes, "You know, keep standing if you do 5K regularly." And then it's like, keep standing if you do, you know, if you run every single day, keep standing if you do whatever. And he kept going. I can't remember what the final limit was, but he was like, for those of you who are out at 5 a.m. in the dark, pushing to achieve your goals and go beyond your limits and everything that you think is possible physically, we want to be there for you. And that's the company that we're building. Right. And it's like that's the feeling that he was always tapping into. Right. It's like that best version of you at your worst moment and saying, we'll be there when you need us, protecting you with good equipment, keeping you motivated, feel good energy, hence just do it. Right. And then that's how you create that experience, that feeling, that benefit. Right. Because, you know, objectively, maybe Adidas have better shoes than Nike. I don't know. Right. But like they have that feeling, that benefit, that thing that you buy into, and think how many people will buy Nike shoes because they feel they need them to stay fit, to keep fit, to feel better about their exercise regimes, you name it, right? So you're always tapping into something deeper.
Yeah, the meaning of Nike is very interesting because it means victory is Nike, the goddess of Greek goddess.
Precisely.
Is very interesting, like how, for me, like I'm interested of that, like how connecting with like traditional meats, but in these new times.
Yeah.
So we need to recreate them or maybe redoing them. But yeah, sometimes I feel that it's too big, but thanks for all the information that you have provided me.
Pleasure. And look, you got to start somewhere, right? People telling you your vision is too big is usually a good sign that it is very, very challenging, right? Like if you create something that's too obvious or in existence all the time, it's very difficult to understand how you'll be a success, right? Like if you tell me, hey, look, I'm going to go make cushions. It's like, well, there's a lot of people making cushions. Like how are you going to differentiate? How are you going to grow it? What's special about it? So you need to find your niche, right? So focus is good, but like big vision is also good. So like if you, maybe it's on the, like we're going to create a whole new material that could be the future for all, you know, recycled cushions moving forward. Amazing, right? But that's coming from something special that you're bringing to the table. Yeah. So you kind of, you want a certain amount of resistance when you're explaining your business to people, and you also want people to kind of buy into it at the same time. It's a fine line, right? And you'll know when you get that, because for every however many people who say, oh my God, this is amazing, there will be a few other people who will just go, yeah, you'll never do this. This is too big for you. Like, well, how could you do this? It's kind of a good thing. If everyone says it's totally awful, then you kind of have to really have a think about whether you're right and they're wrong, which does happen, or whether you should listen to them. And that's tough. Like, there isn't a right or wrong answer. You've got to be really honest with yourself.
And that is one thing that I talk to my clients about as well, is make sure you are careful who you're listening to as well, because, you know, there's even one section that I go through in one of the programs that I run that, you know, talks about, you might want your mum's opinion. You might really value your dad's opinion, for example, and that's lovely. And, you know, mum and dad love you very much, but that doesn't necessarily mean that they know what they're talking about when it comes to, you know, your new venture and your new, you know, outlook on what you're trying to create. So, you know, they might end up actually giving you some pretty bad advice. So it's working out about whose advice do you accept. And that's not because you don't value them, and it's not because they're not good at something else, but you have to be able to recognize the difference between, I love you and I know that you're really good at this, but you don't understand what it is that I'm talking about. Because that's when people start to take advice, you know, on board that they shouldn't, i.e. people telling them this isn't going to work, or that's too big, you know, what were you thinking, you can't achieve that. You have to ask yourself, is this a person that I genuinely believe understands what it is that I'm doing? And it's okay to say no, even if it's your parents or your sister or your brother or somebody you highly respect. Make sense? Cool.
Okay. So with that, let's head to the next section of the session, which is building on your value proposition. And this is called the business model canvas. This is the arguably the single most powerful tool you will use while creating a business. It's a snapshot, it's a live tool, and it's the most exciting alternative to a 50-page business plan that you can imagine. So, one of my favorite quotes, plans are of little importance, but planning is indispensable. Said by Winston Churchill and God knows how many others, it really is less about having a static plan that you hand people and somehow will therefore make you a good entrepreneur. It's about the active process of planning, thinking things through. Like, what if I can go raise a certain amount of funding now? What if something else happens in the business? How will I win my first few, how will I win client number one? How will I win first five clients, 10 clients? And again, you don't need to worry about winning 100 clients when you haven't won your first one, right? So focus on certain priorities. It is a strategic management and lean startup template and tool for developing new and existing business models. Fundamentally, it's a one-pager. It's a live document. You should be going back and editing it, testing assumptions. You should have documents that flow off this, and think of it as the building blocks necessary. Right. Cool. This is the canvas. You can also download this. It's at the bottom of the document we've sent you, but you can also download this absolutely anywhere. There's so many good tools today. It really is considered the number one resource for entrepreneurs building their businesses. And funny enough, I've sent a gift to one of my employees and he's not picking up his door. So I'm going to have to take a phone call and tell the guy to knock again in a second. This is an odd problem to have in the middle of a call. Laura, can you explain these kind of stages and I'll click through just while I tell this guy where to go?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, no worries. Okay.
Generosity doesn't always pay off, apparently.
It'll be worth it in the end, Mark, don't worry. So to make this a little bit easier to understand, we're going to split this out into a couple of different sections. So if Mark clicks onto the next one, the next slide, it will show you the first section that we're going to cover. Or Mark's dealing with DoorDash. Thank you. Perfect. So this is where we're looking at where and how it is that you're creating the value. So we've gone through the value propositions already. With this one, you don't need to do it in quite as much detail as we've done it previously, but being able to put down an example of, you know, what the value is that you're providing in that section is really, really helpful. And then Mark, if you want to go on to the next one, it might be easier for them to see the examples we've got here. So here we go. So to make beautiful, easy to use products that improve the lives of our customers. So this is actually, we're using the example of Apple because it's an easy one for everyone to understand. And you can see just how simplistic that value proposition is, but that's ultimately what it is that they're trying to do. So the difference between the next one on the right, which is customer relationships versus the channels, they're very sort of intrinsically linked together. So you've got, what are your customer relationships? How is it that they are going to be, and then how is it that they're going to be coming into communication with you? So, you know, do you have, for example, a personal assistant? Are they going to be going in store, or is it going to be all online? Are they going to actually speak to you personally, or are they going to speak to somebody completely different? You've got also with Apple, you've got the Genius Bar, obviously, you've got online support and you've got phone support. So there are multiple different ways that the customers can have a relationship with the people within Apple. And then the channels are, how do they do that? So they can either go into Apple stores, they can do the Apple store online, they've got iTunes, there's adverts underground. That's another form of communication, even though, you know, two people aren't actually speaking necessarily. You're learning something about Apple. It's the whole point of sort of marketing and advertising. It's called a touch point. When somebody sees something about you, your company, your value, what it is that you provide, it counts as a touch point to them. Usually the saying is that it takes around 7 touch points for somebody to be confident enough to in you, your brand and your product, to be able to sort of purchase and move forward. And obviously there's TV adverts as well. And then you want to look into the customer segments. So what is it that, you know, which different types of customer are you attracting with the product or the service that you're offering? So with Apple, you've got style conscious people, designers, young people. You've also got people within the education sector as well. You know, we talked a lot earlier, you know, Mark was saying about the fact that, you know, you want to be that person that goes into a cafe, you know, and flips open the Apple laptop rather than anything else. It's all about a want rather than a need for those kind of style conscious, you know, young designers. You've got non-computer owners, non-tech savvy users as well, potentially, and affluent aspirational people. If you think about the price of a Mac versus the price of another computer, you can get another computer for like a tenth of the price sometimes. They're not necessarily trying to advertise to everybody. They have their market and they know that their customer segment includes people that have that little bit more cash to burn. So that's the sort of the value end side of things. Mark, do you want to go on to the next one? Excellent. So this is about, do you want to take this one, Mark, actually? You look like you're keen to go. That you're on mute.
So, Laura, are you waiting for me? Because he keeps calling.
He's still calling.
Going.
Blimey, he's not really getting a good job done, is he? That's fine. I'll keep going. No worries. Okay. So in this section, so that's obviously the first one. We can sort of break it down. We can take the first section. And this time we are delivering the value. So once we have created the value, we've defined that value, we now need to deliver it to our customers. So we're talking now about key partners, key activities and key resources that we're going to need. So in terms of being able to create your product, create your service and deliver that over to your customer, who is it that you can use to help you with that? You know, you can utilize bigger businesses, you can utilize other entrepreneurs, you can utilize so many different people in order to be able to help promote your new product or service. So Apple, for example, you can buy an Apple in John Lewis, you can buy an Apple from multiple different places. So they're utilizing other partners in order to be able to provide multiple key touch points for customers to be able to purchase their product. And it also means that it gets their name out there quicker as well. You know, from a sort of maybe like a social media perspective, it's utilizing other people's audiences. So, you know, being able to partner with other entrepreneurs or being able to partner with other businesses that are able to, you know, get your product out there far quicker, far easier and to a much larger audience than you currently have is actually a very, very smart strategic decision to make. So key activities, we're then looking at, you know, what is it that you're doing to deliver this product? So you've got obviously product design. You need to be able to create something that they want. You've got sales, you've got marketing. How are people going to know about what it is that you do unless you market? You've got genius appointments, supply chain. So think about all of the aspects of bringing that product or service together. And what is it that you need to do to get it from where it is now in your head to an actual viable, visible product or service that you are able to put out to the market that's complete for people to take up? And finally, what resources do you need for that? Do you need to take on staff? You know, can you do it all on your own? Or do you need people to come in and help you with that? Finances. You know, at the end of the day, you guys are applying for hopefully a winning grant at the end of this. Do you need that? Is there anything more that you need? You know, are there other people that you could get involved? And then, of course, with Apple, the Apple example, you've got the Apple stores as well. So can you see that the first section we've gone, you know, creating the content, we're now delivering the content. And then the logical next step, if anybody knows what's coming, Mark, if you can click onto the next one. Perfect, thank you. We're going to capture the value. So capturing the value essentially is what money am I bringing in and what money is going out. So you've got your cost structures and your revenue streams. So cost structures are things like, are you outsourcing your manufacturing? Have you got to pay staff? You know, there's for the Apple example, you've got your lithium batteries, you've got advertising, you've got shipping to customers. These are all costs that you will incur or Apple incurs when you or I were to purchase an Apple Mac, for example. And the revenue streams, you've got the actual hardware sales. So you've got things like iPhone, Macs, et cetera, all the accessories that they come with it. But you've also got things like iTunes now and the App Store sales as well. So they've got revenue coming in from lots of different areas. And even if you're not in that stage just yet, because obviously you have your one product or your one service, if you can see an evolution and you can see whereby, you know, this is the starting point, but I'd love to take it to a position where I'm able to offer this and this as well, then absolutely put those in revenue streams. It's something that I think that the judges would really like to see for a start. It's also good for you to be able to visualize it. It's something that's really nice. You know, like Mark said, that this is a live document. You want to be able to come back to it. You want to be able to sort of update and change things. It's a nice reminder of where you're going. So even if it's not something that you can actually deliver on yet, it's definitely worthwhile you know, putting down anything that you have in your mind as to sort of, you know, further down the line and further into your journey. And that is a nice sort of simple way of breaking down what ultimately looks like a very complicated document. But hopefully you can see the huge benefit of being able to understand a business from just one single page, being able to look at everything there and knowing that you as the entrepreneur have considered all different areas of where things are happening, who you're working with, why it's going to work that way, the cost structures, where money's coming in, you know, and what value it is that you provide in one simple page. So Mark, if you want to click onto the next one.
Yeah, fab. And just to echo what Laura said, you know, really encourage you to think of this as a living document. Keep editing it every time you learn things. There's not a finished version. But think about when you were doing maths at GCSE, if you just provide the answer, people are going to go, well, how did you get that answer? People really want to see your working out and your logic. And even more so if you have a, you know, if you have a new business concept, something that's not immediately obvious how it will succeed, this is particularly important in generating trust in you, trust in your business, and trust that you're going to make some money. And then speaking of making money, the next stage of this, for those of you who are interested, is the social business model canvas, which is very similar with a few important differences. So in the middle, you have the type of intervention. On the right hand side, the value proposition, you're almost always going to have two, one for the beneficiary and one for the customer. The beneficiary being, let's say, young people at risk, and the customer in this case would be restaurant goers. So you're funding young people to start their careers in restaurants, learning both the skills to make food, prepare food, the attitudes and so forth, keeping at-risk people away from, say, reoffending, you name it. So the customer value proposition in this case is good food and a clean conscience, which is very different to the beneficiary value proposition, which is providing high quality training and a community and keeping people from reoffending. And then at the bottom, when we talk about money in a social enterprise, a social venture, it's very much about reinvesting it into your social outcomes. So fingers crossed, you're going to have lots of surplus for lots of growth and funding those good outcomes. So this is the social business model canvas. There are so many resources online. I really encourage you to go ahead and take a look at them. Strategizer is amazing. There's plenty more. I really encourage using a resource called Miro to build these because it's an amazing whiteboard. We use it internally a lot. And you can download a ton of templates. And then, of course, you have the template at the bottom down here. So we really have another 10 minutes. Have a stab at the business model canvas. Or if you'd prefer to go back to the value proposition canvas, you can do that. But I really encourage you to make a little bit of progress and then come to Laura and I with some questions. And then we have the Rene team joining us at 1:45 to talk about their experience in the competition year before last, I believe. I'm going to have to check. So, yes, crack at it. And please let us know with questions. Hey, Frida.
Hello. Hey, Razi will be with us as well. So we're doing it together. Is that all right?
Lovely, perfect.
And in the meantime, please do ask questions, guys, if you've got challenges, concerns, comments, gaps in your knowledge, things you want clarification on.
I have a question.
Yeah.
So, Laura, Mark, thanks so much for such a nice session today. This is not a question related to the business model canvas, but I have a question regarding the categories for the competition. So I'm thinking of entering two ideas, but I'm afraid they might be in the same category. So I was just wondering, how could the health sector differentiate from the social enterprise sector? Does it have to be, because one of my ideas could be health related, but it is addressing a social enterprise issue in the community.
Okay. So this might be one for the MERS team to actually chime in on. The only thing I would say is that it's kind of how you want to position it. Because if it is a social enterprise or you feel like there is a social enterprise aspect to it, then you could submit it within the social enterprise section. It doesn't therefore necessarily matter that it's health, because obviously social enterprise covers a variety of different things. And then if you have something else that really is health, then you can separate it that way. It will just depend upon how you position it in your application and how the team view it. But yeah, like I say, does one of the team want to actually kind of weigh in on that and just...
Yeah. Yeah, I'm happy to jump in there. So as I've sort of mentioned on the chat, you can't have two ideas in the same category. So if there is an element that is sort of social enterprise and it still sort of covers health, absolutely fine. Do it under the social category and put your other idea onto health. That's absolutely fine. You know, sometimes ideas have sort of crossovers anyway, so it doesn't really matter. And if that solves that issue for you, that's absolutely fine.
Yeah. No, that's good. Thank you so much.
Okay.
Okay, before we wrap this section up, does anybody have any questions about the business model canvas or anything in relation to what we've talked about today? This is your final opportunity for some help.
I didn't have the, it is three segments, right? It's create the content, delivery the content, and which was the third one, the exact word?
The one at the bottom, value capture, capture value. So it's all value rather than content.
Okay.
That's all right, no worries. Lisa, you have your hand up. Would you like to ask a question?
Yes, thanks. I have a question regarding the customers, because in my case, I want to work on a company for VR, like for education. So there's like this thing where like you have one customer, which is like people buying the product, which in my case would be like schools, but then you also get like the parents involved and you also get like the one using it. So like, do we separate like customers and users? Do we make different type of document? Like, how do we deal with like many people being involved in the end product?
So I would probably encourage using the social business model canvas.
Okay.
The border of what is a social business is always shifting, right? You know, I would say that I run a business with purpose. I don't consider it a social enterprise by definition. But then, you know, this does allow you to clearly and distinctly show the difference between your two value propositions. So what's the value proposition for the kids, and what's the value proposition for the school or the parent, whoever's purchasing it, depending what it is that you're actually doing, right? And then that allows you kind of greater focus as well.
All right, thank you for the answer.
Right, no worries.
And again, if I'm wrong, then you'll figure that out yourself and you'll find a better way of doing it, right? Like, that's the whole joy of this. And again, you'll all get advice from lots of people. It doesn't all mean it's going to categorically be right. The point is that you're stepping in one foot forwards at a time. You're always learning, you're closing those feedback loops, and then this will only get more accurate. And again, I really encourage you to write down, you know, things that you do not know, right? Like, known unknowns are a lot better than unknown unknowns, because they're the things that come at you without you knowing what they are or when they're going to happen or how much they're going to cost.
Yeah, and at the end of the day, this is meant to be a helpful tool for you. So, you know, if you find a better way of being able to get your thoughts down on paper, then that's great. And also, you know, if this is something that you're showing in a funding situation or an investment situation in some way, shape or form, and you get feedback or they ask you questions or they go, well, what about this? You know, you can always add to it differently. There's no right or wrong answer to any of this. This just provides you a framework to work on.
Exactly. And then ideally, when you get lots of smart questions from mentors, advisors, potential investors, you know, it's less important whether you know the answer or don't know the answer. What's more important is that you know it's an issue, when it's going to be an issue, and how you're going to tackle it whenever you're going to tackle it. Right. When you look surprised in meetings that someone asks you about stuff, that's what really undermines you as a young entrepreneur, because you might be going, oh my God, I've never even heard that term. I don't know why it's important. But tools like this help you figure all these things out. So then you don't get any surprises. And with that, let's wrap the session there. These are great materials to bring to mentoring meetings. So I'm going to post up. I'm going to post this in the chat. Please do book in a mentoring session with Ed or the team. If you bring things to review, it's always often more helpful than just coming and chatting, right? So that brings us to the end of the kind of the curriculum. And now we can do the really fun bit. We have two wicked entrepreneurs from last year's program, right? Yeah, 2022. So we've got both Frida and Vassi here. I'll pass you over. The floor is yours. Give us the introduction. Tell us how your journey's been, and then we'll do some questions from the audience.
Amazing. Thank you.
I'll share some slides
if that's okay. Let me just find it. There it is. Can you see my screen? Yeah.
Yes. Yes, we can.
Amazing. There we are.
Perfect. So we are here with Branding Materials today. Thank you so much for having us here. We won't give you any tips for how to win that competition because we didn't win, but please feel free to ask any question afterwards. So this is us, it's Vazi and me. Vazi is a creative strategist and campaigner. I am an expert in textile handcraft and I'm a material expert. So these two different fields in the collaboration that really helped us to develop the idea of Renee Materials.
So we were, we actually were design students at the moment that we did the competition. Now we're design practitioners. And being design students made us really understand and relate with our peers that constantly said how sourcing material as creatives is incredibly expensive and unsustainable. So the idea came up one day, we were just walking through the streets of Capem and we found a big roll of paper just thrown into the garbage bin. And it was incredible because we thought how expensive something like that would be if we would have to buy it new and how valuable it would be for our practice. Just because something was at the wrong place at the wrong time with the wrong name, it was discarded as waste, while any creative mind could have made something beautiful out of it. And this is how Renee was born.
Renee aims to build the bridge between those who produce a lot of waste and those who are in need of materials. So how do we do this? We get from companies, that can be companies, workshops, museums, and theaters, we get their leftover materials and we match that with student makers and creators.
Originally, the idea was meant to be a platform. Actually, when we signed up for the competition, it was just a draft, just an idea. We had nothing. We just quickly prototyped something and tried to see how it could work. Basically, our plan was to make companies be able to upload their offcuts, leftovers, and surplus stock onto the platform and then make it available for students to reuse it to the project. And students could just contact directly the companies and then could go and pick it up from the company directly. It was basically a too good to go bit for materials. So the value proposition here was students got affordable material at a low price and it was sustainably sourced. Companies could make money off their waste, and London has a goal for 2026 to be a circular city, so it would get closer to achieve that. So when we started the Mayor's Entrepreneur Competition, as I said before, it was just a draft, it was just an idea. We had interviewed quite a lot of students because we were into UAL, which is a big campus, so we had access to many students, and we actually felt the need of students to find sustainably sourced materials and affordable materials, especially given the cost of living crisis. However, getting in touch with companies was a bit more difficult. We knew there was a problem. We knew that 28% of London's total waste was produced by companies and businesses, but they were a bit more difficult to get on board. We still tried to interview them and kind of understand their flaws and pain points, but we were really, really early stage and we had no testing at all. So then we did the Mayor's Entrepreneur Competition, which was amazing. We got so much mentorship, we got so much help. We are creative, so we knew absolutely nothing about startups. We knew nothing about how to make our idea viable and our the business model. We didn't even know what a business model was. And I remember quite some little stupid questions. Well, there are no stupid questions, but there are stupid questions. So we asked some of them and it was really, really useful for us to go through the Mayor's Entrepreneur Competition. It actually made us be in touch later on from May to September 2022, where we started to really move forward with the idea. It was an incredible boost. And we reached out actually to Jamie Crummy, who is Too Good To Go's CEO, and that actually did the Mayor's Entrepreneur Competition. And we found out when we were pitching as finalists, and he's now mentoring us, which is also incredible. And it's thanks to the Mayor's Entrepreneur Competition, he said that as well. Then later on from May to September, we interviewed 20 companies. We actually got on board more than 200 students, creatives and makers, and everybody was really excited about the idea. So we decided to move on to testing, so our MVP.
So then from October till December last year, we launched a pilot. So we changed our business model going from a digital to a physical and actually testing this interaction with students, workshops, and external companies. So we got lucky and we got an amazing spot at one of the best design universities in the world, Central Saint-Martin. And there we opened our first circular material hub. And now we are in 3 months of testing and it's still ongoing. We had 950 different students using this space. We have 14 companies who partnered up with us. And within 2 months, we were able to put 2.6 tons of materials back in the loop. On this slide, you get some impression how this space looks. It's improvised, but it's perfectly usable. Now also putting this presentation together, if we look back where we were 1 year ago and where we are now, it's really amazing to see. And as Vasi was already pointing out, thanks to the Mayor's Entrepreneur Competition, who really pushed us to get testing done and to get that idea out there.
Yeah. Yeah, we're currently creating a blueprint to bring this space into other campuses and other universities as well. And we just launched our website, actually, and we tried to make our online community grow. It's incredible because you have so much user-generated content that you can reuse, and people are really engaging. So if that feels interesting for your university or yourself, please feel free to drop by. And yeah, thank you for having us. Are there any questions?
Thank you, guys. That was really interesting. Really appreciate you coming on and letting us know about that. Anybody who does have questions, if you want to put them in the chat, then either Mark or I can pick up on those and we can pass them over. But yeah, I guess for me, if I start it off while we're waiting for a couple of questions to come through, I'd love to know a little bit about your experience actually going through the Mayor's Entrepreneurship Program. And, you know, what were, for you guys, what was the biggest benefit that you found from going through the process?
I would say that it would have been amazing if we would have known about all the mentoring you're already giving now. So we, like, it was all very last minute. So, please, guys, go to the session. They prepare it for you. Because at the end, I don't know, like, the stupid question Vasi was referring to was me asking what the market size is. And it was, like, a few days before we were pitching or something. So it was, it would have been very, very beneficial for us if we would have joined the session. And in general, Vasi, do you want to take what we did benefit from, what we did not miss?
Well, yeah, I mean, it was everything that all the information that they're giving you right now is really, really valuable. And then we went through the slides again and we kind of rushed through it, but it was really useful to kind of get things done. And from a communication point of view, we were already more or less set for the pitch as well, but it was really useful to be able to pitch in front of a big panel of investors, kind of also play. We had these signs, we had these little papers with all our pitch drawn on it, because of course we have to do something weird as creatives. But it was really interesting to see how they engaged with these signs that we were holding. Because they found it interesting and they kind of got into the key points that we wanted to come across. And the questions were very much related to that as well, not only communication-wise, but business-wise as well. So, yeah.
I bet that made you stand out quite a bit as well.
Yeah, they, Love Actually. That's what we call it now, right now.
So we have a question here from Tomohiro. He says, any tips on how to approach businesses to interview?
So I think the experience we did, since we have it in an environmental social purpose, is if you look for companies who already are within this bubble. So that would be one tip of mine from me. And the other tip would be that personal connection, so relationship building, experience is so important. So if you know anyone who is part of one of these companies, try this one first, because it will be always beneficial for you if you can tell them a name, or like if they just can give you the right email address or phone number.
Yeah, I definitely agree. Like, this is something that really struck me, how especially in the entrepreneurial world, people are really like, they are available. They want to help you out because they have been through that as well. And so the support that we got from our same field was incredible. So if you really know anyone that is in the field that you're interested in and ask, do you know any business that would be available for an interview or a talk? I think you should go that way. Of course, being a student helps because people sometimes are more available to speak to students rather than to other people that think that they have, that they want to sell something to them. So of course, maybe you are selling into an idea, but you're trying to make them be part of your team and part of your process into the idea. And that's very different. And people are normally quite available to do so, especially with students.
Yeah. And then, for example, just today, I went to a company. We have been partnered now for a bit, but it was still good that we presented us in person. So now, like, I could really feel how this handshake was changing also a bit, how much they know about us and how much they trust us. So, yeah.
We've got a hand up from Lisa. Lisa, do you want to ask a question?
Yeah, thanks for the great insight. I have a question, like, how did you make the transition between being a student and being a founder? Like, right now I'm still like in the middle of like thinking of where I want to go, where do I start like advertise myself as a founder or CEO of a company? Like, when do you make that move and how does it feel?
Love it.
So that's a great question. And we're in the process as well because we just graduated. But yeah, we felt like we were funders quite immediately. I think having a physical space that you can really manage and organize really helps you take ownership over it and say, I'm the founder of Rene Materials. But at the beginning, we were, because it was in collaboration with the university, we were seen as the students working into the swap shop. Right now, we're actually the founders of this circular material hub called the swap shop and the founders of Rene. So right now we're actually doing many more meetings with the universities and so on. And it's just kind of, I guess, feeling it, kind of say, I'm a CEO. And from a legal point of view, of course, it's a completely different thing. But personally, I think, yeah, it's just feeling that you're the CEO now. You can decide for your own business and feel a bit more secure. Not a student, but a real professional that is taking over their own business.
Or I would actually answer it more from, it depends how much you believe in hierarchies. So I think between CEOs and students, if you look at that, both are curious and wanting to change something and want to build something. So maybe there is not even too big of a difference, and then maybe it's really profit from that you, profit as a student that you can just try and error and you don't really have to pay for your mistakes. Maybe that will be, if you're a proper adult later differently, I don't know. But I think like I would see it more if, as I know that there's this whole mystery around this term of CEO, but I think in an early startup, it's just, we're doing something, we want to build something together. And yeah, it doesn't really matter how you will be called.
Love it. Lisa, does that answer your question?
Yeah, definitely. Thanks. I think it's really like something personal. It's like how you feel it and like when you feel like, oh, okay, I own it now. That's just how you put yourself in front of people. Now I'm just like, well, I'm a student from this company. I work on this project. It's like, oh, I make this company. This is like it's my baby. Thanks.
There's someone that I follow quite a lot. I don't know if anyone's heard of Gabby Bernstein, but she's a very, very successful entrepreneur. And she talks quite a lot about sort of mindset and manifestations around exactly this topic. And one of the things that she said recently was about essentially acting like the person that you want to be before you actually are. So even if you haven't necessarily achieved what it is that you want to achieve just yet. Being able to say, I am the founder of this business, the more you say it, the more comfortable you feel, and actually you end up stepping into that position rather than sort of waiting for it to arrive first and making excuses and kind of being like, oh well, you know, I'm just this person, and et cetera, et cetera. So it's about owning the confidence and just calling yourself the founder from day one. Yeah, lovely. Thank you. Well, I'm very conscious of time. And Frida, Vasi, thank you so much for giving us so much of yours. It was really interesting listening to your venture, and thank you for answering so many questions as well. And to everybody else on here, thank you for your time. It is the end of the session. We've gone through everything on value propositions today. Again, if you have any questions, like Frida and Vasi said, make sure you book in for the mentoring. It is really, really good, and very much worth your while. And of course, you can connect with Mark or I, or any of the other team members as well. Ed and Howard, they're also on LinkedIn. You're welcome to send us messages. You're welcome to ask any questions. And of course, you've got the Mayor's Entrepreneurship team too. So plenty of us here to help you through your journey. I hope today has been really helpful. And make sure you book onto the next session. There is one on Wednesday, just to remind you, that is an in-person version of this event. So don't come to Wednesday's session if you've already been to this one. I mean, you can if you want, but you're going to hear the same stuff. So make sure that you book onto next month's workshops, because we're going to be going through the next iteration of things that you're going to need to know. So that just leaves me to say thank you very much. Enjoy your evening, and we will see you again next month. Bye.
Thank you so much.
Take care, everybody.
Bye.
Thank you, everyone. Bye.
Thank you.